Welcome back, dear students. Welcome to our next lecture on our ongoing topic of environmental engineering, that is, water quality parameters. In the previous lecture, we discussed about demand forecasting, and then we started our discussion on the topic of water quality parameters. I'm your course instructor for this course, Dhruv Saxena. Let us start with today's lecture with our next physical water quality parameter, that is turbidity of water. Please take out your notebooks and please take notes along with me as I write on the screen, and I hope that you are also simultaneously taking the notes as you take in your conventional classroom. It will be very, very helpful in the long run once you write, once you listen to me, once you revise, and once you attempt the problems. These concepts will not go anywhere. Trust me. Okay. So, what is turbidity? We have studied this concept in our chemistry classes earlier, also in the school times. So, turbidity is, in simple words, can we describe it as the extent to which the water is clear? Okay, what is the clarity of water? Then how much the light is scattered or absorbed in that water? So based upon it, let us write its definition. So turbidity is the extent to which light is either scattered or absorbed by the suspended solids. Which are present in the water. Now, a question might come in someone's mind that, so why are we studying then turbidity separately? We have already studied about suspended solids and their calculation. So to make it clear, there is no direct quantitative relationship between suspended solids and turbidity. Both are calculated separately, and main reason being that turbidity implies basically the amount of suspended solids that are present, which might not get filtered, which might not get sediment during our treatment plant process. So we need to do some other processes as well. We'll be learning them in the upcoming lectures. So don't worry about it. For now, let us write this point, that there is no direct quantitative relationship. What does this line means? Ki koi quantitative relationship nahi hai in dono ke beech mein. Iska ye matlab hai ki aapne turbidity ki value nikal li, let us say 100 units turbidity ki value aati hai. To aap koi aisa formula ya koi equation nahi laga sakte जिससे कि सस्पेंडेड सॉलिड्स भी आप निकाल सको, या वाइसा वर्सा कि आपने सस्पेंडेड सॉलिड्स निकाल लिए फिर आप कोई इक्वेशन या फॉर्मूला लगा के कोई वैल्यू सब्स्टिट्यूट करके कहीं पे आप टर्बिडिटी की वैल्यू निकाल सको. अपन अलग से मेजर करते हैं. ओके, बिटवीन टर्बिडिटी एंड सस्पेंडेड सॉलिड्स okay. Now regarding the sources, sources remain same as that we have studied in suspended solid. So same as that of suspended solids. Okay. Next, what are some points? Impacts. What will be the impacts if in a case there is turbidity in the water? So, if there is turbidity in the water, there will be lack of penetration of sunlight in the natural water. If it is a surface water, it will thereby harm the photosynthesis processes that are occurring beneath the water. It will hamper the aquatic life. Okay. Not only that, if I give you again a glass which is having a high turbidity, will you drink it? No. The reason being the same, that it is not pleasing aesthetically, as in the case of suspended solids. So we can't allow after a certain limit turbidity to in the raw water system. Okay. So impacts, let us quickly write down. Turbidity in natural water body interferes with penetration of sunlight hereby inhibits or hampers inhibits photosynthesis reaction during which oxygen is released. Now, if less oxygen is released, it will hamper the aquatic life, hereby prevents the survival of aquatic life. In the natural water body. Okay, these are some couple of points regarding turbidity, its definition, its impacts and sources. Now let us move on to the concepts related to measurement of turbidity. All these concepts are really important. They are asked again and again in various exams, including GATE exam. So have a serious concentration during this topic. Please focus on the ongoing lecture. Take notes continuously with me. So let us discuss the first method that is available to us, which is turbidity rod method. Okay, let me first draw a diagram which will explain you, which will help you understand. Here we have a beaker and here we have a water sample. Okay, now what is the concept in it? We have a graduated scale or a rod, we can say it is made of aluminium. This is an aluminium rod. Okay, it has some graduations. What do we understand by graduation? Markings which has been calibrated to give a standard value in some standard unit. Okay, so this entire thing is marked. Okay, contains marking, and at the bottom we have a platinum needle. Okay, we have a platinum needle at the bottom whose diameter is 1 mm, whose length is 25 mm. Okay, now How does it work? We place our eye. We use our naked eye. Okay, to observe that whenever we dip this rod into the water sample, for example, there will be turbidity of any amount. Turbidity might be there. So when we dip this rod inside the water sample, we will take down those reading, that particular reading, when this platinum needle stops to be visible or it is no more visible, then we take that reading that is already calibrated, and so it gives us a value of turbidity. एक बार आपको हिंदी में भी एक्सप्लेन कर देता हूं. बीकर लिया अपन ने, उसमें एल्यूमिनियम की रॉड है, आप देख सकते हो स्लाइड पे, देखिए तो स्क्रीन पे आप देख सकते हो कि एक एल्यूमिनियम की रॉड है और नीचे प्लेटिनम नीडल लगी है सबसे बॉटम पे. अपन इस रॉड को पानी के अंदर डिप करते हैं. ये ऑलरेडी कैलिब्रेटेड है, इसमें कुछ मार्किंग है स्केल की तरह, वो स्केल की रीडिंग अपने आप अपने को टर्बिडिटी बता देती है. अब अपन इस प्लेटिनम नीडल जब दिखना बंद कर देगी तो अपन उस रीडिंग को नोट कर लेंगे. दिखना बंद कर रही है मतलब टर्बिडिटी ज्यादा है वहां पे, तो उस टर्बिडिटी की वैल्यू अपने को मिल जाएगी. एकदम साफ पानी है तो आप रॉड एकदम नीचे तक ले जाएंगे बॉटम तक इस बीकर के, तो भी आपको प्लेटिनम नीडल दिखेगी, बट जब टर्बिडिटी है तो ऑब्वियसली ये सस्पेंडेड सॉलिड जो भी पार्टिकल्स हैं इसमें ये आपके हैम्पर करेंगे विजिबिलिटी में, सो अपने को टर्बिडिटी की वैल्यू मिल जाएगी. ओके, नाउ लेट अस राइट सम पॉइंट्स रिगार्डिंग इट. व्हाट इज द कंप्लीट वर्किंग ऑफ दिस अपैरेटस? सो द फर्स्ट पॉइंट इज दैट इट इज अ फील्ड मेथड. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आप बड़े आराम से अपने रॉ वाटर सोर्स के पास जाके इस टेस्ट को कर सकते हो, इन विच एल्यूमिनियम रॉड हैविंग प्लेटिनम नीडल एट टिप हैविंग अ साइज ऑफ 1 mm एंड लेंथ ऑफ 25 mm. इट इज इमर्स्ड इन द सैंपल ओके एट द हाइट ऑफ 1 mm. This platinum needle ceases to be seen, or as I explained, ceases or stops to be visible to our naked eye. This reading is noted. Okay. To give us the turbidity of this sample, to give turbidity of sample. Okay. Now this value is in standard units. Now next thing, next concept related to it is how do we obtain the standard units for this? The answer is quite simple. See how we have calibrated the scale, we should know. What are the possible ways? What can we do? Think upon it. We can take a particular type of material. We can standardize it. Okay. For example, in this case, we take Fuller's earth, that is SiO2. We take it in a certain amount in 1 liter of pure water, we mix it thoroughly, then we take readings at different level, and then we compare those readings and we calibrate the scale, and accordingly we get the value of turbidity. Okay, so let us write down that these standard units, they are or that are obtained by addition of SI, that is silica, in powdered form. Silica in powdered form as in the form of SiO2 or Fuller's earth. Or we can also say it as silica dioxide. In 1 liter of pure water. Okay. Next, what we have? Now, we need to learn that these markings are showing us turbidity in some units. What are those units? So, the units of turbidity, they are expressed in terms of, can anyone guess? They are expressed in terms of milligram per liter or ppm, that is part per million, milligram per liter or ppm, that is parts per million. This term you can recall it from your chemistry class of 11th and 12th. If there is a doubt in such terms, then please put it in the comments box so that whenever I take the next lecture, I will be addressing that particular issue. Or we take the value as STU. What is the full form of STU? Silica turbidity unit. Why this term is used, STU? STU shows that we have done a turbidity test. This is a unit for turbidity, first of all. Okay. Thirdly, the standard sample that was prepared, it was prepared using the powdered form of silica. So this silica will represent the what was the standard material that was used. Okay. I hope it is clear. Now write a note that from our naked eye, when we say that I have give you a glass full of silt and clay in it, will you drink it? So what is the minimum value in terms of these units? It will give you a general idea. Okay. So any turbidity which is greater than 5 units, it is directly visible by the naked eye. Okay. Let us write this also. Turbidity greater than 5 units can be easily detected by the naked eye. Okay, next method for measurement of turbidity is Jackson turbid meter. Let us try to understand what is happening in this apparatus. So again, I am drawing a water beaker, a beaker that is containing the water sample. So this is your water sample. Okay. Now this entire flask is graduated with some markings. In the previous one, the rod we dipped was marked. Here the beaker is marked. Okay. Now, We also put a candle. Let us put a candle. So this is the flame of the candle and this is the candle. So what we do, we observe with our naked eye directly from the top of it. So what do we measure here? This is our water sample and there might be turbidity in it. So the reading at which this flame, it ceases to be seen, okay, or it stops to be seen, that reading we take as the value of turbidity based upon Jackson turbid meter. Okay, simple. Let us write these points down. I hope you have drawn the diagram. Now, is it a field method? No, it is a laboratory method. It is a laboratory method. Which gives turbidity of sample it is greater than 25 units. Okay, this apparatus is used whenever the expected turbidity is greater than 25 units. Hence, it is not used for water supplies because, hence, it is not used for water supplies. Why? Because generally, in the water supplies, this much turbidity is not allowed. But this method is readily used. For testing of natural water sources. For example, there is a groundwater source, so there is a high probability that it will be having a high amount of turbidity. We will use this Jackson turbid meter there. Testing of natural water body. Next, about the working. So, in this test, water sample is placed in metallic container having glass bottom provided over an ignited flame. And the depth of water at which the image of the flame ceases to be seen is noted. To give the turbidity of sample in standard units, which is expressed as, again we can use the same unit such as milligram per liter, ppm. We can also use STU because here also the standard solution for turbidity measurement is prepared using silica. We can also use a unit JTU, which is nothing but Jackson turbidity unit. Okay. Now note an important point that in both the tests that we have studied, that is Jackson turbid meter and rod method, in both the methods the concepts remain the same. That is, we observe the length of the path of the light through our naked eye. That how long has been the length of the path of the light. So what we observed, that longer is the path traveled by the light, smaller is the turbidity, and in case shorter or smaller is the path traveled, then lower is the higher is the turbidity value. Okay, so write this point down as a note. It will be helpful in overall understanding. So in both the above cases or in both the above tests, principle remains the same. That is, longer is the length of longer is the length of path traveled by light, smaller or shorter is the turbidity. Okay, now with this, let us move to the next method we have to measure turbidity, is Bayliss turbid meter and Neflometer. Now both of these turbidity measuring devices, they are basically based upon the concept of light scattering and also the color matching technique, and light scattering and light absorption. So using a simple setup, we take a standardized sample and we also take a test sample and we throw some light on it. So based upon the observation, we will definitely observe some color in the standard sample and we will observe some color in the test sample. So for different standard samples, we will take and note down those colors, and for test sample, we will find out the color whenever we do the test. We match them, and hence the name comes color matching technique. And with the help of this color matching technique, through that calibrated readings of the color of the standard sample, we find out the turbidity using the methods of Bayliss turbid meter and Neflometer. So let us write down the points. Let us also understand the design of the apparatus. So it will help us in getting the concepts behind these two turbidity measuring devices. Okay, so let us start. Let us quickly write down some basic points regarding to it. So both these methods are based upon color matching technique that can give turbidity of sample even if it is less than 1 unit . Okay, we can use it for any amount of turbidity within the water sample. Hence, it is readily used for testing of water supplies. That is the treated water and also the water for treatment. Okay, for testing of water supplies. Next, let us understand the construction and working of this test apparatus. So, this test consists of standard and test samples . I am quickly defining what I mean by standard sample. So, with standard sample, I mean that the sample for which turbidity is known . Okay, and test sample is the sample for which turbidity is unknown . Okay, next we'll write that these samples are those which are being subjected to source of light that induces color in them, as I explained to you. Intensity of which is further matched. So basically, we are matching the color intensity between the test sample and the standard sample. Okay. Now, if if the intensity of color in the standard sample is same as that of test sample, then turbidity of test sample is also known as also considered to be same as standard sample. Turbidity of test sample is also considered as same, considered as same as that of standard sample. Okay, I hope it is clear. Now, let us understand how the test is done. I am drawing the basic layout diagram for this. So, this is your apparatus. We have a bulb here. दिस इज योर कोबाल्ट बल्ब, ओके, सॉरी, दिस इज योर नॉर्मल बल्ब. द प्लेट इज ऑफ कोबाल्ट दैट विल बी यूजिंग. आई एम रियली सॉरी. दिस बल्ब इज ऑफ 250 वॉट्स, ओके. नाउ व्हाट वी यूज हियर इज अ ब्लू कोबाल्ट प्लेट दिस इज द कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ दिस अपैरेटस नेक्स्ट व्हाट वी हैव हियर आर द टू ट्यूब्स ओके नाउ वन ट्यूब हैज द टेस्ट सैंपल I'll use the short form as TS, whereas other one has the standard sample. So we create a number of standard samples for different amount of turbidity. We match them one by one in this apparatus, and for whichever standard sample the color is matched. We label that test sample to have the turbidity same as that of standard sample whose color has been matched with it. Okay. Now, this is based upon the perspective of the person who is testing. Two different person might give some different reading for any particular sample. So what now it is being done that now instead of the intensity of color, we measure the intensity of current in those test sample and compare it to the standard samples. And when we measure the intensity of current, we have directly the meters that will tell that which is matched to which will make our entire result will much more efficient and optimized. Okay, so let us quickly write down these points. Now, in order to improve the effectiveness, of this test. Intensity of current is now being measured instead of intensity of color. This is done with the help of photometers. It is what are photometers? Photometers are basically devices that emit current whenever light strikes them. Okay, so for different colors that are observed from the test samples. Those lights will be emitted onto the or transferred to the these photometers and they will give a particular current reading. The concept remains the same that color matching is being done, but not through the naked eye, but through the use of photometers. Okay. So photometers are devices which produce current when light is incident upon it, okay? Now, some points regarding Bayliss Turbid meter and nephelometer separately. What separates them? So, Bayliss turbid meter, it is based upon detection of incidence of light, okay? Whereas in nephelometer, the intensity is measured at right angles. So, the Bayliss meter is based upon the absorption technique, whereas nephelometer is based upon the principle of scattering. So, this is the major difference, okay? So, let us quickly write this down. So, in Bayliss turbid meter, intensity is measured in the direction of incidence, whereas in nephelometer, the intensity is measured at right angles. Right angles to the angle of incident, okay? So, hence, the Bayliss turbid meter is based upon absorption principle, and nephelometer is based upon scattering principle. So, meanwhile you write, take down these notes, I'll have a water break. Okay, so I hope you have written these points. Now, nephelometers, the turbidity that is obtained from it is given as NTU. Okay. Now, let us quickly write about it also, the units in which it is expressed. So, in nephelometer, turbidity is expressed in terms of standard units which is obtained by addition of formazine. Now, what is this? This is hexamethylene tetraamine, and it is used as base instead of silica. So, the standard material that was used earlier, that is silica, in case of nephelometer, we used formazine. Let us write also the exact name, the chemical name for it. Hexamethylene tetraamine it is used as the base instead of सिलिका, ओके, इन 1 लीटर ऑफ प्योर वाटर. एंड इज एक्सप्रेस्ड एस मिलीग्राम पर लीटर. इट इज ऑल्सो एक्सप्रेस्ड एज पीपीएम एंड एनटीयू, दैट इज नेफ्लोमीटर टर्बिडिटी यूनिट. इट कैन बी ऑल्सो बी एक्सप्रेस्ड एज एफ टी यू, इन विच एफ टी यू इज फॉर्माजीन टर्बिडिटी यूनिट. ओके, नाउ लेट अस ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड वॉट आर सम एक्सेप्टेबल लिमिट्स इन वॉटर सप्लाई इंजीनियरिंग. These standard limits have been formulated by Government of India and are given in the Water Supply Manual. So, let us have a look about turbidity. So, the acceptable limit of turbidity is 1 NTU. Okay, only 1 NTU is allowed, and the value of cause for rejection is 10 NTU. Now, this might be a new term for all the students who are studying this subject for the first time here. So, I will just take a couple of minutes to explain the difference between the acceptable limit and the cause for rejection value. Okay. Now consider a situation in which the lives are going normal. There is none type of disaster or any type of emergency or any issues with treatment system or any of the other problems doesn't exist. So in that case, the acceptable limit for the turbidity in drinking water is 1 NTU. Okay. But let us say there is some sort of emergency. It may be of because of any of the reason due to which either the water is not getting treated properly or there is a high demand of water in and the time is not there to treat it more efficiently. So in those cases, we extend the limit till the value of cause for rejection. And even in the case of emergencies, we will not allow the value of the water supplied, the potable water, to be more than cause for rejection value. एक बार मैं इसको हिंदी में भी एक्सप्लेन कर देता हूं कि एक्सेप्टेबल लिमिट आपकी लिमिट्स हैं जो कि नॉर्मल टाइम्स में, जैसे कि अभी का टाइम ले लीजिए, तो अभी ऐसी कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. लेट अस से मेरे सिटी के बारे में बात करूं, अभी मैं अजमेर में हूं, तो यहां ऐसी कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है कि मुझे कोई इमरजेंसी हो, कहीं वाटर ट्रीटमेंट प्लांट में कोई प्रॉब्लम हो, या जहां से पानी आ रहा है उसकी कोई पैरामीटर एकदम से चेंज हो गए, या आज मेरे यहाँ पे कोई लोकेलिटी में कोई ऐसी सिचुएशन है जो इस चीज को हैम्पर कर रही है प्रोसेस को, तो मैं एक्सेप्टेबल लिमिट तक ही चलूंगा, दैट इज 1 NTU. नाउ कॉज फॉर रिजेक्शन क्या है कि किसी भी टाइप की कोई इमरजेंसी आ जाती है कि ट्रीटमेंट प्लांट में किसी तरह का कुछ फेलियर है, सोर्स से जो वाटर फेच कर रहे हैं उसमें किसी तरीके का कोई चेंज है, तो मैं क्या करूंगा कि कॉज फॉर रिजेक्शन वैल्यू की तरफ मैं जा सकता हूं. आई विल अलाउ द वॉटर दैट इज कमिंग आउट एज ड्रिंकेबल वॉटर विच इज सप्लाई टू द कम्युनिटीज टू गेट टू रीच द वैल्यू ऑफ 10 NTU. इस तरीके से अब भी अपन जो भी क्वालिटी पैरामीटर्स जो भी अपन आगे पढ़ेंगे, बी इट बी फिजिकल और बी इट बी केमिकल, हम हर एक में एक्सेप्टेबल लिमिट भी पढ़ेंगे एंड कॉज फॉर रिजेक्शन. What I am saying is that in all the upcoming water quality parameters, be it physical or be it chemical, we will be studying both the acceptable limits and cause for rejection values. As a GATE aspirant and as an experiment for other competitive exams, you should know these values and you don't need to mug up these values. Eventually, with number of revisions, and these values will be directly imbibed within you. You will never forget. Okay. Now, consider talking about the water supply manual. I have read it. You can also read it. It's available on internet. There are n number of values regarding to various things, but we are not very much focused, or we are not going for a detailed study as we go in the university. So what we are much more focused is about the GATE exam as well as the other competitive exam. So the questions revolve around these concepts only, and if you are well versed in these values and concepts, then no one can stop you from scoring full out of full in the subject of environment. The questions are that simple. You just need to understand each and every concept. You need to remember the terms, these type of limits, values, and there will be no problem with this environmental engineering subject. Okay. Now let us move ahead. Let us start our discussion on next water quality parameter, that is color. Okay. Now color, again, if there is a presence of color in water, will you drink it? No. Is it a physical or chemical? Yes, it is a physical water quality parameter, because we can see it, we can feel it. Feel it by our eyes. Okay. Now definitely we will not be using this water even for washing purposes, because it will change the color of our clothes. Then in the presence of chlorine that we will be adding eventually as the last process of disinfection. So when chlorine is added into the water, and if there is a presence of color causing compound, then there might be a possibility that the chlorine and these color causing compounds, they might react together, and they may lead to development of carcinogenic compounds. That is, what are carcinogenic compounds? The compounds that may lead, or that may become a reason for development of cancer. Okay. These are some points. Another point is that presence of these color causing compounds, it will lead to increase in the usage of chlorine, because the chlorine that we will be using in the disinfection process, firstly, it will be used here. It will react with it. Chlorine is a very strong oxidizing agent, and it will oxidize all these compounds, and it will turn them into different compounds. Okay. And those compounds will also develop taste and odor in the water along with the color. These taste and odor causing compounds and carcinogenic compounds may be formed due to this action. And that is why it is very important to remove any type of color from the drinking water. So let us start our discussion on the quality parameter, that is color. So first, let us discuss what may be the sources, what might be the impacts. Again, sources remain the same as suspended solids and turbidity. These compounds will definitely, from where they will come, if we are taking the water from river or a lake, definitely these colors are from the bed material or the material that is flowing along there or stagnant there. Same, they also become the source for the suspended solids and turbidity. Okay. Now, what are the impacts? A lot of them are similar to that of suspended solids. That is, it makes the water aesthetically displeasing. You will not find yourself comfortable while drinking it. That is one of the impact that is same as suspended solids. I am just adding the other impacts that might be possible. Please write it down along with me. Yeah. Colored water cannot be used for washing and dyeing purposes. Next, certain color causing compounds which might be organic in nature, they might react with chlorine and result in formation of carcinogens. What are carcinogens? Cancer causing agents. Okay. Next point is that certain color causing organic compounds like phenol, they react with chlorine to give taste and odor in water. How does this happen? This is your phenol. When it reacts with chlorine, it readily oxidizes it. Okay, and this particular compound, it is yellowish brown in color. It gives taste and odor along with the color. Okay, this is your phenol. Next point is that certain color causing compounds that are organic, they increase the demand of chlorine that increase the demand of chlorine in water, thereby reduces its availability to carry out disinfection which in turn affects the efficiency of chlorination chlorine which is a strong oxidizing agent hence reacts with the color causing organic compounds. Now, let us study the concepts that are related to measurements of this color. How do we measure the intensity or the amount of color? Okay. Now, the color of the water sample, it is again determined by the concept of color matching technique, and here Nessler tubes are used. So let us quickly write about the construction of the apparatus and how the color is determined. What is the technique used here? The color in sample is determined using tintometer which uses Nessler's tube. I will explain you what these terms are. Let us firstly take points about it. I understand that today's lecture has been extended a little because we have covered multiple concepts here and there were a lot of note taking today. I hope you don't mind that for some lectures, we have taken a little bit extra time for the day. So the next point here is that the intensity of color in water sample is determined using the color matching technique. And is expressed in terms of standard units and is obtained by addition of platinum in the form of chloroplatinate ions in 1 liter of pure water and it is represented in terms of milligram per liter or ppm, that is parts per million, or TCU. TCU stands for true color unit. Okay, now let us understand the construction of the device here, how these Nessler's tubes are used, how tintometer is used. So I am drawing a simple construction of tintometer. Okay, so here what we have 1 tube for the test sample. We have another tube for the standard sample. Okay. And then we have a very small openings. If you can recall from your 12th physics laboratories, we did one experiment, slit experiment. So here also the openings are of size of slit, and through this we observe the different colors in the test sample and compare it with the standard sample, and hence we find out that what is the color in that particular water sample. And the tubes that are used here are Nessler's tube. So these are some things that you need to remember. The standard sample is prepared by the addition of platinum in the form of chlorotratinate ion in 1 liter of pure water. Okay. Now, one important point with regards to color testing is that the testing of color should be done within 72 hours of fetching the water sample. Okay. Testing of color should be done within 72 hours. Otherwise, there might be possibility that it might change its color or some reaction might take place. So we perform the tests within 72 hours of collection. Now, what are the limits? The acceptable limit of color is 5 TCU or 5 true color unit, and pause for rejection values are 25 TCU. Okay. So today we learned about physical water quality parameters, that are turbidity. We learned about the various measurement techniques. We learned about the turbidity rod method, the Jackson turbid meter, the Bayliss turbid meter, and the Nephlometer. Then we discussed some concepts with regards to color matching techniques. Then we moved on to the next quality parameter for today, that was color. We learned what are the major impacts, how it may lead to production of carcinogens in case there are organic color causing compounds. Then we learned the measurement technique of color in the water sample using tintometer. We learned about the acceptable limits. For turbidity, the acceptable limit is 1 NTU. For acceptable limit of color is 5 TCU, that is true color unit, and cause for rejection values for the turbidity was 10 NTU, and cause for rejection values for color is 25 TCU. So that's all for today's class. In the next class, we'll be starting our discussion on the next physical water quality parameter, that is taste and odor, and then eventually we will move on to chemical water quality parameters. So that's all for today's session. For all the students who have joined us today in this fifth lecture, I request all of you to join our Telegram group. If you really like learning from us, from TechU faculties, from me, if you find these lectures to be useful, then definitely do share it with your friends. Do hit that like button and don't forget to subscribe, because only after pressing the subscribe button, we will be able to get the notifications at a regular interval daily. We are uploading lectures daily at morning 10:30 a.m. Also, there is a new information. There will be a link for a Google form attached here in the description box. Kindly go through that Google form, fill that Google form. That Google form will be requiring some basic information from you regarding your email, your institute, your branch, etc. And it will be useful for us. When we will be presenting the mock test series for you all for the GATE 2022, and so we will be reaching you on emails for the mock test platforms and how you can attempt the mock tests that have been created and mentored and furnished totally by the TechU faculties and specially for all the students of ours across India. So that's all with today's session for me. I hope you enjoyed today's session. You learned some new things. You revised some new things. Take these notes. Take a look once again. And we'll meet tomorrow at the very same time, 10:30 a.m. in the morning. So see you tomorrow. Have a nice day. Jai Hind.